the most. There's one verse that it is definitely the most difficult to practice. They asked him, which verse is this? And he said, it's this verse, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. ثم جعلناكم خلائف في الأرض من بعدهم لننظر كيف تعملون. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that generations before you perished, we brought you as heirs to the previous generations to see how you behave. Not how much, but how you behave. Thus, it's quality and not quantity. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that we are watching, لننظر. We created you to see how you behave. Yes, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants quality from us and not quantity. Because we all worship, we all pray, we all fast, we all perform pilgrimage, we all give khums. However, it is not all the same. Not all those who fast in the same way. Not all those who pray in the same way. There's a difference. Because every action has an intention and a motive behind it. And it is that motive which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala considers properly. In the Quran, Allah praises the Ahlul Bayt in this verse, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, وَيَطْعِمُونَ الطَّعَامَ عَلَىٰ حُبِّهِ مِسْكِينًا وَيَتِيمًا وَأَسِيرًا. Allah mentions the story of the Ahlul Bayt when they fasted for 3 days, and on each day they could not break their fast, because on each day, one day a person who was needy comes to them, one day a prisoner, and one day an orphan. They come to them and they ask for food. Fatima Zahra takes that which she had cooked for iftar, for the breaking of the fast, which was several loaves of bread, and she gives it to the poor. Allah praises the Ahlul Bayt in the Quran for this act. Why? What is it that they gave to these needy people? Was it gold or silver or diamonds? What was it that they gave? It was none other than several loaves of bread that have, monetary-wise, they have no value. Maybe several dirhams at the time. No more. Their value was very low. Yet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala praises them in the Quran. If you and I were to give loaves of bread, how come Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not mention us in the Quran? Maybe there were thousands, if not millions, of people at that time that also gave loaves of bread. People that fed, people that would slaughter camels and sheep and feed hundreds of people. Yet Allah does not mention them in the Quran. He mentions the Ahlul Bayt that donated loaves of bread. Why? Because giving them this loaf of bread meant something. The Quran tells us why. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, إِنَّمَا نُطْعِمُكُمْ. This is the words of the Ahlul Bayt. إِنَّمَا نُطْعِمُكُمْ لِوَجْهِ اللَّهِ لَا نُرِيدُ مِنْكُمْ جَزَاءً وَلَا شُكُورًا. We don't wish, when they give to these needy people, they didn't expect them to thank them or give them something else in return. Rather, they knew that the reward was with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. إِنَّمَا نُطْعِمُكُمْ لِوَجْهِ اللَّهِ. We give you for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. لَا نُرِيدُ مِنْكُمْ جَزَاءً وَلَا شُكُورًا. We don't wish for you to thank us, nor a reward from you. This is why we give. Thus, it is how we act, and not what we do, and not what we act. It is not what we do or how much we do, but it is how we do that act. It's all about quality, brothers and sisters. On the day of Ashura, when Imam Hussein, at the time of noon, it was time for Salat al-Dhuhr. The camp of Imam Hussein alayhi salam stood to pray Jama'ah, and the camp of Umar ibn Sa'd on the other side stood to pray Jama'ah. If we were there to look at their prayers, we would see a big difference. We would see that the camp of Imam Hussein prayed very quickly, in a rush. Salat al-Khawf, the prayer of fear, as its laws have been mentioned in the books of Islamic law. The prayer was very short. They prayed out of fear, and their prayer might have taken just several minutes. However, when we look on the other side, on the camp of Amr ibn Sa'd, we see that their prayer probably took longer. They were more comfortable. They extended their prayer. It was more organized. Thus, quantity-wise, if we were there, we would judge that Umar ibn Sa'd and his followers prayed a much better prayer than the camp of Imam Hussein alayhi salam. However, in the eyes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which one had more value? Of course, it was the prayer of Imam Hussein alayhi salam. On the day of Ashura, when his companions and his family members knew that they only had minutes to live, yet they stand and they pray during that hour, this means a lot more. And on the other side, you have Umar ibn Sa'd. He prays, yes, but at the same time, in a few minutes, he is to kill the grandson of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Which prayer has more value? Thus, brothers and sisters, and not all actions are the same. You see two people, they both recite the Qur'an. Their outer appearance is exactly the same. If we were to judge, we would judge them the same way. But yet one of them has the intention to read and just to complete the Qur'an, and the other recites the Qur'an to awaken his heart, to be guided. From the outer side, they're exactly the same. They're both reciting the Qur'an. However, one has the intention just to read. His job is to read the Qur'an. And the other, his intention is to awaken his heart. You see two people that fast during the month of Ramadan. One fasts because his doctor told him he needs to lose weight. And the other fasts because he wishes to feel the hunger of poor people. Two people perform Salat al-Layl. One performs Salat al-Layl because he wishes to show his family members. He wishes to boast about it. And the other wishes, he prays Salat al-Layl with the intention of speaking to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to seek forgiveness and to seek repentance from his sins. Thus, brothers and sisters, sincerity is a very major factor in our deeds, in our acts of worship, and the things that we do. It has been mentioned that Shaykh Abbas al-Qummi, rahmatullah alayh, the author of Kitab Mafatih al-Jinan, they say that after he wrote this book, Mafatih al-Jinan, he took it to the publisher, for the publisher to print this book. Two days later, after he had given the book to the publisher, Shaykh Abbas al-Qummi comes and he takes back the book. He asks for the book. The publisher says, why? He says, I need to review it a little bit and I'll bring it back in a few days. The publisher says that I waited for Sheikh Abbas al-Qummi a day, 2 days, 3 days, week, 2 weeks, 3 weeks. Sheikh Abbas al-Qummi never showed up until 1 year later. 1 year after he had given me the book, he comes back and he gives me the book again for me to publish it, for me to print it. The publisher says, I asked Sheikh Abbas, he told him, what took you so long? We wanted to print your book. He said, yes, I couldn't rush in. He says, why not? He said, because I had put in these words on paper. However, I hadn't practiced what I wrote. I took back the book. I practiced everything that I had mentioned in the book. After practicing everything, now I brought it for you to publish it. This is sincerity in action, brothers and sisters. They also mention another story about Sheikh Abbas al-Qummi. Sheikh Abbas al-Qummi, one of his most well-known and eminent books is called Manazil al-Akhirah, The Journey of the Hereafter, The Stations of the Hereafter, which is a book that talks about the different procedures, all the procedures of the next life, starting from death and ending in either paradise or hell. ending on the Day of Judgment. It's a very valuable book called Manazil Akhira, and it has been translated into English. Anyhow, Sheikh Abbas Al-Qummi had not told anyone about this book. His father would go and pray Jama'ah at a local masjid. Of course, he was a normal man. He was not a scholar or a religious preacher. He would go and pray Salat al-Jama'ah. One day, his father comes to him and he tells him, Abbas, today, the imam of our local masjid, in between the two prayers, he took out a book and he started reading from a book. And it's a very beautiful book. It's a very beautiful book. I wish you can read it. The second day, his father comes back